Randy's Random Rants.
You can realize things many times. You can realize many times, but you know only one time, one time. You can realize many times, but you only one time, one time. One thing you'll want more tonight.
Tells Andre, hey, you know that me and Josephine have been having a sexual relationship for a very long time. And of course, Andre's in disbelief. He loves Josephine.
What is he talking about?
That's her cousin.
Scratch on the back. Come here, touch me like a man. Calm down, Clash. Come out here, Andre.
I'd have walked out there and whipped his ass.
Continue to bang on the door, using all this obscenity. Josephine Gray kind of panics, and she goes out the window.
Look, man, she's gone. Okay.
What
she had
the
actually
fuck?
Gone to her neighbor's home. Since she was no longer in the house, Clarence kind of calmed down a little
but
bit.
But I can't even be too surprised. I've seen it all.
Clarence moved out.
Almost.
Yeah, he moved out. And you two didn't have any words, any arguments.
And don't get me wrong, I was very, very angry about that moment, sir. I wanted to do something. But I love Josephine. I mean, but it was a cousin, for God's sake. Come on, man.
It's too much for Andre, you know. He's overwhelmingly, like, confused. He's in disbelief. He's in denial.
Yeah, well, there's a whole bunch of those running around, man.
He was happy to have some part of Josephine Gray in his life.
You know you must really be in love with someone.
The leftovers
part. If you're not only able to look over an affair, but an affair that was incestuous.
Andre may have been
and not only incestuous, the incest is living right in your house.
Revenge on Clarence.
Did you kill Clarence?
No.
That thought never crossed your mind that you wanted to kill Clarence?
Yeah, it crossed my mind.
So did you kill him? But I did not kill Clarence.
Man, I would have beat Clarence the fuck up.
You know, are you sure you had nothing to do with this? And each time he said...
This nigga ran upstairs to his cousin's fucking room talking about, open the door, I hear what you guys are doing in there. I would have fucking wrapped my arms around his neck so fast, son. That nigga, I would have squeezed until he stopped fucking breathing, bro. Facts.
Is another story altogether.
This totally shocks everyone. Clarence is this kid in their household. Clarence is supposed to be her cousin, and she's supposed to be molding and helping him, but she was really having a sexual relationship with him.
But as detectives wade into these murky waters, they have no idea just how bizarre this case is about to become.
She had this black cloud over her.
People said they saw her with, like, voodoo dolls with pushpins in them, and people would go and actually buy spells.
Alrighty then. It just goes one way or the other, doesn't it? It's either the guy is fucking running around sucking another nigga's dick. It goes one way or the other, doesn't it? It's either a fucking guy sucking another nigga's dick, going back to his wife, kissing her on the fucking lips, and then she plays with his fucking ass because he likes it, and she don't fucking understand why he likes his ass being played with more than she likes her ass being played with. Or it's some fucking bitch that's running around fucking her dad, or fucking her fucking cousins, or fucking her fucking baby brother, or older brother that just came back from the military. Like, it's one thing or the other. So women, watch your fucking man, and guys, watch these fucking nasty fucking chicks that need to have a fucking microscope on them. This nigga ran up the stairs banging on his cousin's door. Yo!
She was sleeping with him in her house while her husband was there. So this is a young man that's supposed to be living in the basement. This is her cousin, actually, that's supposed to be living in her basement, that's supposed to get his life together. And you're slipping down to the basement and having sex with him, and then going back up and sleeping in the bed with your husband.
Slipping down in the basement and slipping
you don't want to wait weeks for
dirty
your
cock
then you have a
in your mouth.
To Jackson Hewitt,
slipping in the basement and slipping cock in your mouth, and then going upstairs to your husband and kissing him on the fucking lips. That man was kissing your cousin's balls. Wow. And the pussy was probably trash. The pussy was probably that fucking, that dry shit that don't even get wet. Shit ain't never gonna cream up on you. Just got like little fucking lint balls inside a fucking twat. I mean, I think all bitches that have incest with their fucking family got lint balls inside of their pussy. And if you're listening and you're like, not me. Yeah, you too, bitch. Are you fucking your cousin? You got lint balls in your fucking pussy. You too, motherfucker. Yeah. Lint balls, bitch.
Clarence Good in the back of his abandoned vehicle in West Baltimore, Maryland. The investigation
see now shit like this I can't feel sorry
Clarence
for you.
Found shot to death and stuffed in the back of his car with a bag of cocaine pinned to his pants. So there was of course the question of whether or not drugs would be involved.
Police also
for real
that
shit like
Clarence
this
was having sex with
I have
cousin,
no pity no empathy no sympathy at all.
It seemed like the more police found out about Clarence, the more bizarre the case became.
In order to better understand this allegedly incestuous romance, detectives pay another visit to Clarence's sister.
We ask you about their relationship.
Clarence's
and
sister,
huh? They were sleeping together. Do you think this was still going on when he died?
You never know with her. I would not rule it out. Josephine is manipulative and conniving. I know that she will continue to pursue whatever it is that she wants.
She was very domineering. Clarence was afraid of her, and I think just over time he was trying to get away. She wouldn't let him go.
She would make trips to Baltimore. She would call him.
She was stalking him, but yet it's like she had some power over him. I mean, here's a young man who, when he talks to family or friends, is afraid of her, but yet whenever she calls for him to do something, he goes and helps her.
How stupid do you sound?
Josephine, they knew, or at least they felt she had something to do with
this
murder, but
how afraid of somebody can you be when you run up the steps in a fucking fit of rage, anger, and jealousy when you hear...
Maybe it was because Clarence wasn't the first one of her lovers to die under suspicious circumstances.
This nigga heard her getting screwed by her man and he runs upstairs and fucking banging on the door.
Not only
look at you. It don't sound like a motherfucker that's scared of somebody to me.
After reaching
ain't
out
sound
to
like
he
was scared of her or him.
Police Department,
he'd have been scared of me though.
Josephine has been
I'd have broke that nigga's neck.
Over
the first bang on the
they
door, I'd have been like, he wouldn't even got a word out. What do you got? I'd have choked his ass out, nigga. Like, tap out, nigga. Just tap out. Shut up. Tap the fuck out.
Josephine Mills at the time was involved with a man named Norman Stribling.
Norman.
Oh, Josephine is just fucking everybody, huh?
Eventually, as adults, they came back together, they rekindled, and fell in love.
But then, 7 years into his marriage to Josephine, Norman Stribling was brutally murdered.
In the early morning hours of March 4th, 1974, Norman Stribling was found murdered at the side of a very rural road in Montgomery County, Maryland.
His car was pulled off the road. His window was rolled down. So at all the appearances, he has pulled off the road, talking with somebody for a while, and then he was shot with a .32 caliber gun in the head.
Wow, this lady is the Black Widow for real.
Suspicion soon fell on Norman's young widow and her fellow co-worker, Robert Gray.
While she was married to Mr. Norman Stribling, she was having an affair with Mr. Gray.
What?
Josephine
this bitch,
and Robert Gray got married shortly
this bitch
after
pussy got the
Norman's
cobwebs
they collected
on it.
Insurance money and bought a house. It sounds more and more.
Look at him. He loves
Robert
her too.
Josephine
your bitch is fucking everybody. Her cousin
Norman
and everybody, nigga.
She said that she was at a party.
People remember specifically that she wasn't. And that in fact, she came back to the party with one of her family members waving a gun around.
As a result,
Robert and Jessica were arrested back in 1974 and charged with conspiracy to commit murder.
Making those charges stick, though, proved easier said than done.
All the witnesses fell apart. They were afraid of Josephine and they wouldn't testify, and the charges were eventually dropped.
For the next 7 years, Josephine and Robert lived in relative obscurity. But when Clarence Good moved in, the couple's marriage took a strange turn.
We don't know exactly when the relationship with Robert started to sour, but most evidence points to Clarence. He started having a sexual relationship with Josephine.
During the time this love triangle was going on, eventually Mr. Gray had had enough, and he moves out.
Robert Gray became so petrified for his life that he just became desperate. He went to family, he went to friends, he went to anyone who would listen, including the police.
Listen, I'm fearful for my life.
Robert talked numerous occasions of being followed. One time he was driving and noticed Josephine following him.
She pursued him in her car, honking her horn, trying to sideswipe him.
She drove up alongside of him. Clarence rose up out of the passenger seat and pointed a gun right at his head. Robert immediately slammed on the brakes and got the car turned around and went the other way.
Wow. Well, that's why that nigga's dead, huh?
But until they could get more evidence, it was basically his word against Josephine. And Josephine denied everything.
But then, 1 month later, Robert was murdered.
It looked like Robert went into his apartment, saw or realized somebody was in a bedroom and turned around, was trying to go to the door, and then was shot twice in the back with a .45 caliber gun, handgun.
So you gotta be ready for cowards
obviously
like this.
Not a burglary, a robbery.
Word, because when you come in your house, it's too late. Motherfuckers be already sitting, waiting for you, ambushing you.
There was no physical evidence tying Mrs. Gray to the murder. But Mr. Gray had taken out a policy, a life insurance policy, of which he was the primary beneficiary.
We felt that we had
that was real smart
evidence to arrest Josephine and Clarence with the murder.
But again, making the charges stick proved difficult, especially once Josephine made bail.
After Josephine and Clarence were released on bond, witnesses started changing their story, saying, well, I don't know, maybe I was mistaken. Some we couldn't find anymore. Some disappeared.
That's two dead husbands.
Murder repeated itself a third time. As detectives are about to learn, building a case against Josephine Gray wouldn't be easy.
Witnesses were flat out afraid of this woman.
They believed that Josephine Gray was a voodoo practitioner queen.
Yeah, well, you guys are a bunch of fucking suckers. That's what I got to fucking say. You scared of the devil? Or you scared of voodoo? Go get the right Bible. And read a couple of lines about Jehovah. Or matter of fact, go write Jehovah on a piece of paper and then go paste it on her head and see what happens. People are scared of her. Scared of some chick riding around, like, man, I'm trying to tell you, boy, I don't know, whatever, but the results of something like this, see, like, this is probably one of the first one of these episodes that I've seen that I have had no empathy or sympathy for the fools that they're talking about. Like, I mean, these dummies. That kid, he didn't deserve to die, though. He should still be alive in jail getting fucked. Seems like everybody with the name that sounds like a Bernstein Bear, they're all fucking weird and fucking a bunch of fucking boneheads. Josephine, Ernestine, Bernstein, any of them shits. They're just a bunch of fucking, like, if they're not crackheads already, they're soon to be crackheads. I'm sure that there's somebody out there with that name that doesn't fit the profile.
And she had this aura of being invincible. She was she was someone we viewed as very dangerous.
And as detectives working Clarence Good's death soon learn, many in the Gaithersburg, Maryland community where Josephine lives feel the same way.
When the police are coming around asking for help, no one will speak up because they're all scared.
And for good reason. She was involved in the practice of voodoo.
A room in her home was set up with all the ins and outs of voodoo. And
does that really scare you?
There were dogs.
I mean, I guess it should scare you.
Needles, and that's one of the rituals that practitioners maybe of voodoo do. That
I believe if somebody tries to do some voodoo on me,
hex on them.
I think some people, I believe Jehovah is going to voodoo
your behind into sprinkles of dust.
Still felt that this was just a completely dangerous
look
figure.
At her.
But if investigators can't seem like, to get people to talk,
listen,
maybe there's another way to get Jehovah to the bottom of this mystery. They begin by reassuring
your behind
of Clarence Good's crime scene.
One problem with trying to pin this crime on Josephine is that Clarence's body was found in a dangerous drug area with crack cocaine pinned to his body.
Still,
poor him. He shouldn't have been running around fucking his cousin and waving guns at him, knocking on doors. I would have knocked him the fuck out, son. Word, son. I'd have waited until he ain't have no gun, or I would have went into his room and got his gun and pistol whipped his ass like Kane did Chauncey.
And the Baltimore City detectives had interviewed Josephine, and she didn't admit to anything with Clarence's murder. She had nothing to do with it. She doesn't know why he was killed. It wasn't her.
I just had these voodoo dolls in the bottom of my basement.
But when detectives
with his name on it,
phone records, they discover she had made a curious call just hours before Clarence Good's body
to
was
who? The
found
voodoo
in
priest,
Baltimore.
Right? The voodoo priestess?
Oh, here's something. She made a call the day of to a pharmacy.
Ahmad Alibad Pharmacy.
Maybe we need to start there.
Good idea.
There's a phone
call. Dundada Alibad.
Josephine's house.
Dundada.
Pharmacy.
Bombada.
House. Well, and looking further, when we got those pharmacy records, it was a prescription. Clarence was sick. He had some type of a sinus infection.
We had them pull all the logs from that day, and we found the sign-in log for Josephine Gray picking up a medication for Clarence Good. Josephine Gray was the last one to see him alive, really. And not only did she lie about it, but it put them together, and it put Clarence at her house.
Oh, yeah? Was she giving him head, or?
So we conducted a search warrant at Josephine's house.
Eating his ass out?
I think I've got something. One of the things they found was a red stain.
A shit stain.
On the flooring of the garage.
We weren't able to get DNA.
That's one of the shit stains from one of them
to determine that it was
after
blood.
They was eating each other's ass.
Suggested to the investigators that, in fact, Clarence had been shot there in that garage.
Our theory was that he was shot at Josephine Gray's home, and that Josephine Gray drove that car to Baltimore City, where the car was abandoned.
That theory seems to dovetail nicely with another powerful piece of circumstantial evidence.
She cashed in when her first husband, Norman, died. She cashed in when her second husband, Robert, died.
Well, guess yo.
What? Detectives find out that Clarence also has a life insurance policy on him for $100,000. And I'll give you one guess who the beneficiary was. Josephine Gray.
She got a life insurance policy on him, which he knew nothing about.
While the blood evidence found in the garage, coupled with the many life insurance policies, suggests Josephine is responsible for the deaths of three men, investigators believe they'll need more concrete evidence if they hope to indict her for Clarence Good's murder.
Here's a woman they believe that had skirted justice not only once, but twice now. So at this point, they're going to need someone to come forward to testify.
That's what happens for these people that got demons living in them. Like, she ain't even the woman that she, or the girl that she probably was when she was a little girl.
Getting him to cooperate,
she's just a body.
We have reason to believe that she probably killed Clarence.
She's just a capsule.
Nah, not just.
Or a vehicle being driven by demons.
To do with any types of murder.
And guess who's next?
Josephine loves me, and I love Josephine, so I don't think she could ever do something like that to me.
Are you sure of that, Andre? Did you know that she's taking an insurance policy out of me?
Insurance policy?
Yes, sir.
On me?
We tried to lay out very fairly for him that we were very worried about his safety. There were red flags popping up all over the place.
We interviewed Andre many times. But as we talked to him more and showed him more evidence, he saw the light of day, especially when we told him that she had taken an insurance policy.
Josephine Gray behind bars. Or will she remain a free woman, ready, willing, and able to kill again?
Oh, shit. I think he died from that puff bar. This is what happens right here from vaping.
Leaving a trail of dead husbands and lovers in her wake.
She was attracting men, seducing them, but also killing them at the end. And Josephine was able to do that in three different occasions.
In 1996, following the shooting death of her lover and cousin, Clarence Good, police are hopeful they finally have what it takes to bring Josephine to justice.
There was a lot of circumstantial evidence pointing to her involvement, that she was killing these men for insurance money. There was also a lot of blood evidence in her garage that suggested Josephine killed Clarence.
I want to know what kind of...
But charging Josephine with
crack it is that they got in the water in Maryland. I've never been to Maryland. I have no gumption to ever want no
oil.
Weeks turn into
I have no passion and no will to ever go see Maryland. Like, all I hear about in Maryland is a bunch of senseless murders, like people just dying for nothing. Like, you got like almost everybody and their grandmother got tattoos on their face walking around in Maryland.
Almost a decade after Clarence's murder, detectives hit the jackpot in a most unexpected way.
People just be dying for no damn reason.
Under a coherent theory of fraud,
they find that there was an insurance fraud scheme that happened from the $17,000 check that was paid back in 1976.
I mean, what is it that they be doing out there?
After her first husband, Norman Stribling's death.
That, like, this is what they do. This bitch is killing every nigga she fucks.
You can't get money on a life insurance policy.
Y'all got some real demons out there running around, boy.
They don't have to show that she, in fact, caused their death, but that she contributed to their death.
On January 4th, 2002... authorities arrest Josephine at her Upper Marlboro home and charge her with 8 counts of federal mail and wire fraud.
Her reaction never changed. Very stoic. No screaming and yelling. Very, very calm demeanor. I didn't do it.
What did you want her to do? Be a banshee?
6 months later, on July 30th, 2002,
not all witches
are banshees. Deliver their opening statements in the United States versus Josephine Gray. They assert Josephine reaped an estimated $163,000 from the 3 separate insurance policies she held on Norman Stribling, Robert Gray, and Clarence Good.
Josephine has 2 motives in all of these murders. One is money. She was obsessed with money. Also, when
Snickers bars. And also Snickers bars.
That's it. I'm done. She can't take it anymore. I'm moving.
She uses that money for Snickers bars. She needed money. And she just needed fucking Snickers bars.
Robert Gray's deaths, they turn to the last victim, Josephine's lover, cousin, and confidant, Clarence Good.
She was more or less his surrogate mother for years. Then that relationship crossed the line and became sexual until Clarence tried to put an end to that relationship. She didn't like that.
How did he try to put an end to it if he's running up the steps, getting mad that somebody's screwing his cousin?
Secrets. He knew every skeleton in her closet.
Before June 21st, 1996, Josephine convinced Clarence to drive down to her house. After filling a prescription for him at a local pharmacy, she shot him in her garage and drove his car to Baltimore.
She's like, that dick their claims, is not good enough, Clarence.
Call a number of eyewitnesses to the stand.
There were several people that testified at the hearing, individuals that said that any time Clarence Good would be with another woman, Josephine Gray would really go off and become almost like a lunatic and become very threatening.
Almost like a lunatic?
Other people had testified they had heard her actually threaten to shoot and kill Mr. Good.
Almost like a lunatic.
Nigga,
she's a fucking lunatic.
Gray had tracked down a witch doctor and
three killings.
And testified at trial that
incest with your fucking cousin, nigga, you're more than a lunatic. He said almost like a lunatic. Look at her. You don't call that loony?
Josephine's defense team attacks the credibility of many of the Fed's witnesses.
Ms. Gray had two very talented defense attorneys who represented her quite zealously.
This is what happens when you want to play with demons, everybody.
They made an effort
you want to play with voodoo and get thumbtacks and stick them in fucking Barbie dolls and shit. This is what happens. You could go kill whoever the fuck you want. Just know that this is the ending for your ancestral voodoo-loving fucking bozo ass.
Andre Stevens.
His information was critical. This is somebody who's intimately involved with her. Josephine told investigators that she was home the night Clarence was murdered. But Andre testified that he had picked her up at a Greyhound bus terminal in Baltimore the night Clarence was missing. The assumption is she had killed him and had to get back.
Andre also talks about how possessive and controlling Josephine could be.
What about how possessed she is?
Became prepared for his life.
Andre's powerful testimony seals the deal. On August 17th, 2002, the jury returns with its verdict.
The jury found her guilty and sentenced her to 40 years in federal prison.
40 years?
That was probably the best feeling I had from
40 years?
All the convictions I had gotten in my career, and I did this for 31 years.
Today, Josephine Gray is incarcerated at a Baltimore federal detention center.
It's unlikely that she will ever breathe the air as a free woman again. She's gonna die in prison. She seems to be truly an evil, evil woman. They call her the Black Widow, and that seems fitting because every one of her mates wound up dead.
If somebody didn't really know her on the face of it, she comes off as just a really a nice, sweet person. But behind it all, I mean, she put a knife in you in a second.
She got the opportunity. Why are they not showing her real face and her real pictures?
They'll never have that opportunity ever again.
Are you guys fucking her too? Huh? Are you guys having incest with the bitch too? Why the fuck are you not showing everybody? What's with this? With Marilyn? It's just a bunch of murderers running around.
Call the police. Yeah, Asha called the police and they met him there and they forced entry and went in.
Leslie!
There was nobody home.
Leslie!
There's no real evidence of foul play. There's no blood. There's no witnesses of any kind.
They went in. They saw that everything looked normal.
But as officers searched Leslie's condo for clues, they quickly discover not everything is as it appears. And the villain in this Hollywood mystery is as real and as terrifying as any bad guy you'd see on the silver screen.
I think everyone was stunned when the truth came out. It was just impossible to believe.
Leslie Telford was born in the small South American nation of Guyana in 1964. The oldest of three children, Leslie grew up in a loving home, surrounded by those she most adored.
Leslie kind of played the role of surrogate mother to her little sister, Asha.
Leslie was this person who had this big smile and warm demeanor. She made friends easily and she kept them.
Growing up, she had dreams of seeing the world and taking advantage of every opportunity life had to offer.
She graduated from high school in Barbados and then went to university in Canada. After college, she went to Paris and then moved to America.
This is how I'm coming for y'all on my YouTube channel, you heard? don't wanna be talking shit, huh? You don't like the commentary, bitch? Blam! Shut up. Yeah.